right, it's day four of Gen Con. We're here at the Dark Age booth with Cary, who's going to tell us a little bit about his game.
All right, we've got our line is fully fleshed out with four different armies. We've got the Forsaken, which is our main core army at the top. We've got some Dragari, which are our alien race. We also carry the Scarred, which are our mutated kind of cyborg type armies.
Mm-hmm.
And then we've got our Brood over in the far coast, which is kind of our, I guess, gooey mutant army. For a lack of a better term.
I'll see about getting some better pics of these guys. They're not going to show up too great.
That's fine. The game is based on alternate unit activations. It's a very small skirmish game. You're going to run somewhere between 10 and 20 figures, depending on which army you play. When you sit out and you start playing, each unit is going to move you. I'm going to activate a unit or an individual. You're going to activate a unit or an individual. And what that does for you is it allows you to both play at the same time.
Right.
One guy watching.
Instead of I go,
play.
You go, yeah.
Exactly. And I throw a couple of dice for armor saves, and then you get 20 minutes of watching me play, right?
Right.
This way, every movement that you make makes me choose which unit or which individual I'm going to move next. And, you know, as you're moving, it basically makes my game plan a flowing strategy. So it's constantly changing back and forth.
So I would drop
it is relatively inexpensive to get into. Our box sets for our unit forces run around $40. That is 500 points. Our tournaments are 750 points.
Oh, okay.
We're looking at about $70 to get in to play a tournament army. We have three different rule books currently. The core rule book that has the Dragari and the Forsaken in it. We have two other rule books. Each one has a faction of the Forsaken in it. You change out the leader and the elite units where all the four troops stay the same. The Scarred is pitted against St. Mary, which is our female saint. The Brood are pitted against St. John, which is our close combat saint. Big army, power field, and a big power hammer.
Mm-hmm.
And then St. Mark is our original saint, which is the most range combat army. He has a plasma rifle, so when you're in a post-apocalyptic world with a plasma rifle...
You gotta have that kind of stuff, yeah.
It's good stuff. All the artwork is based on Rom, who was the...
Oh, yeah, I know, yeah.
If you're familiar, did the box cover for Diablo 2. Did a lot of the player's handbooks for WotC.
Absolutely.
The art director there, so very S&M feel to a lot of the troops, especially the human troops. Very post-apocalyptic feel.
Nice.
That's where we get all of our original concepts. Most of the figures will have a prom concept that we've done directly off the painting or the image, where it'll be a very static pose, very loose.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Then the second one, we'll go back and redo the image and do it. I mentioned with a lot more movement, a lot more dynamicness to it, to try to get more of us. So we have both worlds. We have guys that want to paint a prom figure that looks exactly like a painting. You have that option, the same pose, very static, and then you have the gamer's figure, which is, you know, flying up in the air with weapons out, cloak blazing, that type of stuff.
That's interesting. I don't think I've heard of anybody doing it that way before.
Yeah. Most everything in the books, out of all the books, there's two figures that are not sculpted, so the line's probably got 70 sculpted miniatures in it now. Duplicates of some.
Because the game's been around for how long?
It's been out 7 years.
Okay.
We released it in 2002 at Gen Con. We've been sort of hanging back a little. We push it some. We sell a lot online. You know, we didn't really put a big... You know, most of our initial investment went to the game.
It was
creating miniatures, creating art, creating books, not advertising. So now that we've got our solid product line, now we're going to push it a little harder.
Gotcha. Now, you guys use metrics for the metric measurements for the game, right? Why is that?
We use everything. We break down the percentages so we can get more varied, more degree of variation between the units. So, by going with centimeters, we basically went with half inches.
Right.
And that allowed us to have, for example, a unit that moves 3 centimeters and a unit that moves 4 centimeters and actually have a difference between, you know, the two rather than both of them moving 2 inches and being the same thing. So
right.
You get less degrees of separation when you go into inches because it's just a bigger measurement. It also made it easy for our ranges. All our ranges are based on how many full 10 centimeters you are away from the target. So if you pull out the tape measure, you're 30 centimeters away, you're at -3, 30 centimeters is at 1. So
cool.
When you get into, also we use the D20 for the same reason. Everything's based on a D20, so you get 5% variation between different numbers.
It's a nice distribution curve on the D20.
Rather than the 15% you'd see with the D6.
Sure.
So a lot more variation between your really good units and your poor units. The other thing, too, is that we use low dice, so you want to roll as low as possible. If you roll ones, you bypass armor and just draw a complete wound, so you have a 5% chance every time you swing to just immediately wound with no armor.
Uh-huh.
Vice versa, if the person's rolling an armor save and rolls a 20, they really fail it and they take 2 wounds. So, you know, you can see these large models get attacked by a really small model and end up taking, you know, an automatic wound on the first roll, hits him the second time, he may roll 220s and be dead. You know, and you see a 130-point, 140-point model die to a slave, a 10-point slave.
Ouch.
Very rarely does that happen, but it's nice to have the chance. You know, if luck just is not on your side, sometimes a game can swing just purely off of a good play or a lucky play, and then you're having to climb back out of the hole.
Right,
the game tends to swing back and forth a lot with the two players playing. But 99% of the time, that slave will win because, you know, it's a 17 or less on the D20.
Sure.
Hardly ever does he fail that, right?
Sure.
The other thing that you're gaining with D20s and the fact that it's a low base, and the reason why we did a low base is the math is very easy.
Right.
If I want to hit you, I have an attack score. I look at it, say it's a 6. You have a defense, say it's a 5. I add them together, roll under it. It's 11 or less. It's a very fast mechanic. The game goes really fast because of that. You're always adding and subtracting inside the 20, and the roll is always low, so it's very easy to keep up with.
Nice. Talk a little bit about your pricing.
The pricing on the game, what we did is we tried to make it a miniature gamer's game. For example, two of the female Dragari. Female Dragari and
hang on just a second. I've literally not been able to shoot a complete interview without having the damn PA guy bust my chops. It's really making me insane. So, excuse me just a moment while we... okay, there we go.
They've been announcing all kinds of things that we're not interested in.
Exactly. Okay, sorry.
Take the Dragari, which are our dragon line, which we'll show kind of some pictures of those in a little bit. They the females are $12 a piece. We have a female character named Ivanka, and she's, you know, the arbiter for the Aircast. She's still $12. She's the same size. She's the same amount of pewter. She's still the same price.
So just because she's a character and just because she's got a lot of power in the game doesn't mean that she costs a lot of extra money, huh?
Right. We base the miniatures on what it costs us to make the miniatures. We have some resin kits that you'll see that are really large resin kits. We have some big pewter kits, and they're still under $30. So our most expensive miniatures are $30.
Wow. I mean, in this day and age, that's really impressive.
Right. And that's a miniature on a 50-millimeter base, which would be equivalent to one of the larger jacks out of a machine.
Right. Which, of course, don't cost $30.
No, they don't.
All right. Well, thanks a lot for taking the time to talk to us.
No problem.
Appreciate it.